and part of a broader narrative. A second one that he is going to kind of be reacting to comes from science, right? And again, I always say, you may not believe in science, don't worry, science believes in you, right? Is it science ultimately is what? It's pragmatist. We're going to test. I always say, here's gravity. Gravity's a theory. Oh, look, gravity still seems to be as a theory. If one day this fan doesn't fall and starts floating, whoops, there goes the theory of gravity. That's science. That's being testing and qualitatively looking and saying, here's where we are. And beginning in the 1950s and emerging in the 1960s, the scientific community, particularly in biology, are going to begin to look at the connections that exist within the biological, or the biome, basically. The old school environmentalism was sort of romantic. There's Aldo Leopold, it's a great book, I've read it a bunch of times if you're interested. I'm not an environmentalist, but it's very kind of soaring about the nature of the United States. We're a huge country, we have a lot of natural resources, and it really informs who we are. True of the entire Western Hemisphere. True of Brazilians, Mexicans, Costa Ricans, et cetera, Americans, Canadians. That although the original assumption of environmentalism was sort of like Teddy Roosevelt and the Sierra Club. It's a part of who we are. It's culturally and environmentally. This one right here, Rachel Carson, is going to publish a book which is based on other people's science and her own, which is going to say, no, there's more than just simply a feel-good about science. Oh, look, trees and bunnies and, you know, red-winged hawks and yada, yada. There is a biology to it. It's connected. Simply throwing your trash out and just expecting it to go away does not exist. There's a connection. And what she looks at is DDT, the use of pesticides, and how it affects the water, gets into the water supply. The water supply affects the fish affect the birds. And what you see in the 1950s is a rapid decline of all things the great American bald eagle. Right, is that the shells of these eagles were becoming so brittle as a result of that, is that just sitting on the eggs to incubate them was breaking them. So the very symbol of the United States. Carson writes this book, and it's called Silent Spring. It's a really readable book, so this is a reissue 40 years, now 60 years ago. If you're interested in it, it's really effective in just saying, here's the interconnectivity that exists. And Johnson picks up on this. Not because he's a scientist, not because he's a biologist, but because he looks and says, you know what, we're a great society. We're not just going to look away when hard problems appear. We're going to do something about them. When he talks, this is in 1967, right? Time has come, we cannot be so careless. Unless we do better, we may suffer through a stark emergency of the environment. We may create a hostile world, a world to bruise ourselves against. Look around. Right? If you think there's going to be less hurricanes in this region, you're wrong. If you think there's going to be fewer droughts, you're wrong. There are environmental consequences to industrialization. And again, what does a great society do? Too bad for you. I can go move somewhere else. I can live in an apartment complex. I can do whatever. Understanding the reality of the world around us. I like this visualization. Right? We live on a rock, a really, really big rock. That is all the water and all the air. That's it. Right? It seems like a little bit, it just a little, you know, people talk about the atmosphere in the water is like the skin on an apple. And that skin on an apple is actually thicker than what our atmosphere is. To understand that you got one shot, right? That's it. Where there's no new water, right? You know, in the universe it appears that liquid water is the essential ingredient for life like us. Right? So we have a whole abundance of it on this planet. What do we call our planet? Earth, right? You know, go figure, right? Because we live on it, whatever. Same thing is true with the air, right? You don't get a second shot. You don't get to, oh, well, we screwed this up, and too bad, it's only going to take 10,000 years for us to deal with this. Again, in previous classes, I would show this clip from An Inconvenient Truth, and it would immediately get tossed into the same kind of sixth grade partisan bullshit, right? Oh, it's Al Gore. Oh, it's this. Oh, it's that. Right? Because it makes it easy. It's real easy to throw this stuff out. Science doesn't give a shit. Science doesn't care. You don't have to realize, you don't have to believe in science. It believes in you, right? Meaning it is going to continue as it goes. I'm not going to play the clip because Al Gore is sort of kind of goofy when he does this. What I'd like to do is kind of start with it. What he's talking about are these Arctic ice shelves. And you can dig down into these Arctic ice shelves. And it's ironic, they use oil and gas industry material. And you take these core samples. And you basically take a tennis ball can and shove it down as deep as you can go. And you can see in these ice samples all these little rings that are going on here. These are different seasons. And in the ice is air that was trapped and turned into the ice at that point in time. So you can keep the ice cold, you pull it out, you thaw it out, out comes the air that was frozen 100,000, 200,000, 300,000 years ago. And when you look at it, you can say how much carbon dioxide was in there, how much nitrogen oxide was in there, how much of the greenhouse gases do you see in there, right? And he goes through this process, at the end of this clip, he goes through this process to show you what is referred to as the hockey stick graph. Right? Gore is going to famously run for president in 2000. He is going to, in essence, run into the Bush, you know, the Gore versus Bush that's going to be politicized. The first thing Fox News does is to, in essence, sue the producers of this documentary to say, you've made all these numbers up. They're all fake. To the credit of Fox News Corp, they hired biologists and scientists to do the exact same thing. What does this final graph that I'm going to show you is from Fox News Corp.
Count right? Back.
Sorry, there's Bob Gorgon. They find the exact same thing, which is what? Beginning about 100 years ago, 200 years ago, we start dumping into the atmosphere all of these waste products from what we're doing. Right? Go away, go away, go away. Right? That's what my generation did. Your generation is going to look around and go, where'd the polar bears go? And more importantly, back to Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, which we've known for 60 years now, is that when you lose the microbiome at the smaller level, what does it mean? It means you're going to lose the macro level, you know, macrofauna, bigger animals at the top, right? That is it's as set as a scientific principle as gravity is. And Johnson's response is, what is a great society going to do? Right? Oh, we're too poor, we're too, you know, torn up, we're too much involved in our own politics. No, a great society is going to pass legislation. This is where the core of America's environmental legislation is going to come from. Nixon ain't going to pass any, Obama and Clinton aren't going to pass any, Bush and the rest of them aren't going to pass any. We're going to build on what Johnson is going to establish initially in terms of saying, I understand it's convenient to have your own car. It's American. I wrote a damn book on it. It's American to have your own car, to use automobiles as a kind of an expression of American individualism and freedom. But you can't just say, well, I don't give a shit about what consequences there is to my freedom. I don't care if, you know, the hunters out there, that you're no longer going to be able to go hunting because, in essence, those environments are going to be gone, right? That there are consequences, and a great society owes up to them. They're not childlike, they're not sixth graders, they're not people, well, they're just not, you know, that's just bullshit, right? They own up to it. So civil rights, enforce them. The Constitution means something. The environment, again, something that is beyond Lyndon Johnson's, he's a Southern, he's a Texan, he likes to hunt and fish, right? So he's familiar with the environment, but not a biologist, right? The third one that he is going to focus on is something that he is familiar with, and that is poverty. Again, a great society, the wealthiest country on the planet. And we went back to the Gilded Age, I showed you that. We still are the wealthiest country. We could buy the People's Republic lock, stock, and barrel and still have money left over for a lot of smaller European countries if we wanted to. Right? That's how wealthy we are. And one in four of us are living in poverty. So that big fancy house down the street that has all the toys and all the cable and all the things you want as a consumer has got a quarter of their family, who gives a shit? They're living outside. We don't care about them. Johnson sees this. He knows this. He grows up in this environment. The Hill Country in the 1930s was one of the hardest hit in terms of the Great Depression. So he is familiar with the cost of poverty. Very much like Rachel Carson's Silent Spring, what you see is Michael Harrington's book, The Other America. And what he analyzes is, what does it mean to be poor in a society like ours, in a consumer society, in a society that values participation, right? FOMO kind of stuff. You have to be there to be involved. If you don't have the money to go see the movie, you're not going to be part of the conversation about the movie. If you don't have the money to buy the clothes, you're not going to be part of the society of the cool kids that are going to have. If you don't have a car, if you don't have food, if you don't have medicine, right? You are not part of the United States. You are ignored. And the one thing this country does very poorly is have this conversation about what it means to be poor in this country. Right? We envy the rich, but we don't go, I'll take all their money or anything like that. We don't have that sort of negative view towards wealth. We tend to look at it and say, hey, somebody has really hit the lottery or something along those lines. The reverse is not true. And this is, again, inheritance. To be poor is like an internal alien to grow up in a culture that's radically different from what you experience. Right? The Great Society is aided here by, again, this idea of social gospel progressivism. Jesus of Nazareth, again, I use that phrase, if you're a Christian and a believer, it's Jesus Christ. That makes reference to his divinity. Jesus of Nazareth was a human being. He was a real person. He was 5'2", and he looked like somebody from the Middle East. So, he doesn't look like a lot of the images you normally see of Jesus of Nazareth. But the central argument that he is making in his preachment, the central argument of Christianity is that you have to care for those people. It is your responsibility to care for those people. If you're a believer at all, you can't just simply say, "Oh, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven." Why? Because I said I'm sorry. Right? That's not what's in the Gospels. It's not the core of Christianity. And the poverty campaigns are going to pick up on that. The reason why there's a lot of religious overtones to it is because a lot of religious service, a lot of religious organizations are going to lean into this. Right? When you hear of people, I have students who will go off on retreats and they go, almost all of them are connected to religious organizations, right? They're judgmental. Yeah, but they're also going out and doing things, right? So this is connected to kind of the core values of the United States in ways that Martin Luther King was as well. What does he do? Well, it's unfortunate he starts this kind of tendency in 1963, talks about the war on poverty. Poverty is never going away. There's poverty of the soul. There's poverty of culture. There's poverty of values that people have, right? Poverty is an element that is endless. It's like acne, right? When I was in my 20s, it's not going away. You can deal with it a little bit. Oh, God, that's it and all that. And it's never disappearing. But you see the beginning of this kind of entry into the political realm. The war on poverty, the war on drugs, the war on evil empire, right? The war on Christmas, for God's sakes, right? This language is violent in nature, right? What the war on poverty is basically doing is using the federal government to provide economic opportunity. That is not the same as cutting checks. Well, there are some instances where you're going to see that, where the federal government is going to provide social benefits. But the money that the Johnson's New Deal, Great Society, is going to spend on is on job training, is on education, is on providing opportunity for people to take advantage of their own hard work and their own initiative. It also looks at, you can see somewhere up here, yeah, Medicare and Medicaid. Medical expenses for those who are either incapable of caring for themselves, mental issues, physical issues, age, youth, right? Or someone who is too old for the elderly, Medicare, to have a job enough to be able to pay for that, right? These are redistributions of wealth. You are going to work, a portion of your taxes are going to pay. For those lucky people who are blind, who are insane, right? Again, this whole discussion, those lollygaggers who sit around and collect checks. We're gonna see what kind of checks they collect in just a second. But the idea that somehow they're undeserving poor, they're old. There's issues that are making it so it's impossible for them to be able to be productive American citizens. And we said in the 1930s, if you work for a living and you spend your entire life producing and being a good citizen and all the rest of that stuff, simply by the time you get to 65 and no longer can do those things, does not mean you just get kicked to the curb, right? This is not writing checks. Who starts the writing checks? Richard Nixon, a Republican. It's continued under Ronald Reagan. It's continued under George Bush, right? It's continued under Donald Trump. Republicans are not pushing back on this. They'll campaign against it, but they'll use, in essence, this argument to third graders. Oh, these lucky poor people. They get to eat cat food all the time, right? They get to live in hovels. Those lucky bastards, right? They get to have no television. They get to have... The reality of it just beggars the mind because people just don't stop and think and say, well, what is it that's going on here? Welfare, yeah.
So 1965,
yep.
Medicare and Medicaid,
yep,
come into existence?
Yep. He's taking the Social Security Act that's already 1935. He's going to amend that and to add medical care for it.
So it's just medical? There's no checks going out to
Two types of checks. Perfect. And that's what people generally refer to as welfare, right? So welfare forms supplemental security income, which is part of Social Security. Stipends for people either too old, blind, or disabled. Those lucky blind people, right? And if only I could be blind, I wouldn't have to work, right? You know, I mean, that's who you're kind of credited. It's called SSI,
right? Until 1974.
1974, right? And then you have temporary assistance for needy families. So you have families that have children. What have the children done? They were born. Oh, sons of bitches, we're gonna make them pay because they were born to a family that does not have money for food, for medical assistance, etc. Right? Cash assistance to indigent families with dependent children. The minute those kids turn 18, boom, you are off TANF. This is not a federal program. It is given to the states, and the states then determine how to distribute these funds. A state like Texas, you can be on these sources for 36 months. Then you're on your own. 36 months. Cumulative, total. So if you do through 2 years now, you only have 1 year for the rest of your life. There's a maximum, the federal law says a maximum of 60-year benefits, and then you're off. That's those lucky bastards. That's throwing checks at. You wanna know where we were throwing checks at in the 60s? Vietnam. That's where we were throwing checks at, right? When you look at the monthly benefits, now this is corrected for inflation. It only takes us to 2006. You can see it goes up, obviously, with inflation. But when it originally, the monthly benefit's $181, it peaks in the late 70s, but basically subsequent to that, all of these are going to get more and more restricted, right? And when you look at, this is again, taking to 2015, who are the poor? Who are these lucky people? There's three ways in which you can be poor, most likely, and I've already mentioned one. To be a young woman, unmarried, who's going to have a child. Right? So obviously, if you don't have an option of abortion, you're now going to have that child anyway. Is the single largest reason someone finds themselves in poverty if you are a single mom, right? The other two are people without a high school education. So they have dropped out. They have obviously been drawn into other paths, usually criminal in the sense that, you know, they're in jail, right? The reason why they do it. And people with disabilities, those lucky people. And when you start looking at the racial compositions, 1 in 7 of Americans, so what we have made progress since the 1960s, who are receiving food stamps? White people are the lead recipients of that. Who are receiving welfare? Whites and blacks are about equal here. How much do you get? 2015 is not that long ago. If you're that lucky and get to do this, you get $4,000 a year, right? Good luck living your life. Everyone, oh well, even if you got $1,000 a month, everyone in this room should know how little that is. You are not going to survive on 12, you're not gonna live a life that you would consider to be fulfilling, that you see for yourself on $1,000 a month, right? What this prevents is someone being evicted from low income housing. It prevents people from living in, you know, dumpster diving for food. And it prevents people from saying, well, I don't have access to healthcare, so my kid with diabetes is now going to suffer blindness as a result of that. Johnson's response, a great society is gonna do that. A great society is not gonna look and say, we're gonna politicize these people. We're gonna call them welfare queens, those lucky bastards who keep getting checks from the government, and we're gonna keep making it harder and harder in terms of means testing to be able to do that. Johnson's argument in the 1960s is that idealism is great, speeches are great, we're gonna do something, right, about this nature of poverty. One of the things you can look at, so this does take us back again to the 21st century. These are all of those programs, TANF, SSI, ACI, housing assistance. Where's the big jump? I mean, you have one in 1985, and that's largely a response by Ronald Reagan to Social Security issues. My Social Security, I'm 60 years old, I'll start drawing it when I'm 62, and life expectancy, old blunky, 30 years. It's fun, right? I don't rely on it, but it's fun. Same thing is true with you guys. Social Security is solid an investment because it is so low risk. Social Security ain't going anywhere. But you can see here, none of those programs have received additional funding since the 1960s, except one. What's the one that's driving costs? If you can follow this chart here. What's the one that's going through the roof? What's the one that is going to bankrupt this country if we don't get serious about it? Healthcare. Right? Healthcare in this country is privatized, meaning that we're paying for things that other people, other societies look around and go, you know, an aspirin only costs about, you know, whatever, 50 cents. If you go to a hospital and get an aspirin, it's $7 for a Tylenol. Why is that? Because of bureaucratic overhead. because of the private sector, because of the opportunity to do that, right? If we have time and get to the 21st century and Obama, what Obamacare is doing is in essence trying to get a lid on this and trying to say this graph is going sky high and you're going to have to pay for it. I'm not. I'm on the back door. I'm walking out the back side of it. Same thing with the environment. What you see here is an attempt on the part of the federal government to be grown-ups about it, is to say, in essence, what is a great society going to do? The politics of this are disastrous for the Democratic Party. Okay? Who cares? Small little violin. I don't give a shit about either of the political parties, right? You know, in terms of political parties. But you have to assume, Johnson, what I was trying to establish is that this is a man who understands politics to his core. He grew up in a political home. He understands power politics. He's able to get Southern whites to vote for civil rights movement, right? This is a guy who understands politics. He's doing this. I think we just gave the South to the Republicans. Yes, you did. The poverty laws will probably lose 1 million votes a month in Democratic states. He's undermining Democratic machines in Northern cities. Why is he doing this? Is he suddenly an idiot, a political fool? You have to say he's doing it and he's using his political capital because he believes these are the right things to do. And I can count on my one hand how many times I say that about American politicians. Right? Sorry, that's just politics. I'm not jaded, I'm not cynical, I'm just a historian. Right? You can see this is a politician who is willing to use the social capital that he has gained through his administration. Very different than John Kennedy. Very different than Richard Nixon, very different than Ronald Reagan, although Reagan will be a totally different story. It's political suicide by a political mastermind, right? And it leaves this historical question of why. And really one of the few answers is because he believed it was the right thing to do, right? He is completely reconfiguring this to the Democratic Party. And the first thing that happens is it's burned to the ground, right? So the Southern segregation, white supremacists are all leaving the Democratic Party in droves. And so a solidly Democratic South is gone. Who is he now appealing to? He's appealing to people who are looking to the federal government to provide some sort of assistance. It is in many ways a reflection of the New Deal, but the New Deal was largely focused on everyone, whereas this is focusing on people who have been left behind, right? And there's obviously political opportunity for that. There are a host of unintended consequences, and here's where things get complex. You are college students. I'm not asking you to do simple things. I'm asking you to do complex things. Other things are taking place at the same time. Why doesn't everybody respond to the Great Society the same way they responded to the New Deal? Why don't you see a kind of a general swell? Because there are these other cultural forces at play. And the biggest one is this generational shift of the baby boom, right? The Great Society is going to be buffeted by youth protest. Young people looking around going, these old people don't know shit. They don't know anything about that. This clip here, first of all, it's a young Jack Nicholson. It's kind of weird. It's called Five Easy Pieces. Of the movies that I show, or at least the clips I show, most of them are really worth seeing. This one, not so much. I mean, it's a great film, but it's just not as engaging. It's a classic 70s film, which usually are kind of preachy and whatnot. It's, what is the context here? It's a group of young people who are crossing country to go. It's kind of like a big chill kind of. They're going to the funeral of one of their friends. Jack Nicholson and three young women, two of them are hitchhikers he picks up along the way. They're young people, and they stop at a diner, and they're there to get something to eat. The clip is clear enough, but I want to make sure I put it into context. He's going to order something that's not on the menu. And what you're going to see is the traditional culture, particularly the waitress or the boss or the authority figures are going to, well, you can't do that. Why can't you do that, right? You got food, you can serve it to me. It's not in the rules. It's not like the 1950s. Everybody in the 1950s, the consensus argument, no one else wants that, so you don't get it yourself. And the response you're gonna see here is emblematic of what you're gonna see in terms of the youth culture response. So again, it's always weird to see Jack Nicholson as a young person. Nonetheless.
No potatoes, tomatoes instead, a cup of coffee and a toast. No substitution. What do you mean you don't have any tomatoes?
Only what's on the menu. They can have a number two, a plain omelet. It comes with cottage fries and rolls.
Now I know what it comes with, but it's not what I want.
Well, I'll come back and make up your mind.
Wait, I have made up my mind. I'd like a plain omelet, no potatoes on the plate, a cup of coffee, and a side order of wheat toast.
I'm sorry, we don't have any side orders of toast. I'll give you an English muffin or a coffee roll.
Well, do you mean? You don't make side orders of toast. You make sandwiches, don't you?
Would you like to talk to the manager?
Hey, Matt.
Shut up. You've got bread and a toaster of some kind?
I don't make the rules.
Okay, I'll make it as easy for you as I can. I'd like an omelet, plain, and a chicken salad sandwich on wheat toast. No mayonnaise, no butter, no lettuce, and a cup of coffee.
And number two, chicken salad sand. All the butter, the lettuce, the mayonnaise, and a cup of coffee. Anything else?
Yeah, now all you have to do is hold the chicken, bring me the toast, give me a check for the chicken salad sandwich, and you haven't broken any rules.
You want me to hold the chicken, huh?
I want you to hold it between your knees.
You see that sign, sir? Yes, you all have to leave. I'm not taking any more of your smartness and sarcasm.
You see this sign?
There's the protest, right? Why are the rules the rules? Because someone enforces them and someone is able to have, in essence, the control over it, right? 1950s, right? They can make toast, they're just not gonna make toast. Why? Because it's not on the rules, and I'm going to enforce it. Youth culture, intelligently, I would argue, calls out this bullshit and says, in essence, you got toast, you can make me a sandwich, right? I'm willing to pay for a sandwich, just give me the toast, that's all I want. Notice, by the way, his response to the women in this, shut up, right? You know, I mean, there's all kinds of stuff involved in that. I always like to say as a sidebar, so my kids when they were growing up always used to watch these things when I was making these. We were at an IHOP one time and I stopped and my oldest was looking at me and she goes, yeah, you want anything else? I said, yeah, I want a side order of wheat toast. I got him to get milk coming out of his nose when he was about 7 years old because he knew about it and started laughing so hard. So the unintended consequences of this, youth protest is finally large enough and capable enough to say, I am growing up in a world that you know nothing about. You may be 60 years old and have all kinds of wisdom blocking, but you don't know what it's like to grow up in the 1990s, 2010s, 20-aughts. You don't know what it's like to grow up in social media native with everything, your life kind of, you don't understand that. And you can't. There's nothing experientially that you can share. They're going to be politicized because of the war. They're going to look and say, why the hell are we involved in Vietnam when we got issues of our own? What do we want the Vietnamese to do that we're not doing ourselves? Students for a Democratic Society are going to house themselves and politicize the university. What are universities set aside for? They're set aside for you to challenge authority, to say things like, hey, what is it like? What's communism all about? What's this all about? Oh, I may not like religion. I may like the... The whole idea of a university environment is to challenge questions, not, you know, lockstep, stand in line, this is who we are and this is what I am, because I've been told this by my television shows, right? So the university is a natural magnet towards this, but you also have to stop and say, who is in the university? And it still kind of reverberates today. People who are not the abject poor, right? People who are not dealing with problems of, specific problems. In particular in the 1960s, they're overwhelmingly white, they're overwhelmingly upper or middle class, and they're overwhelmingly not fighting in the Vietnam War. These individuals are going to, you see this sign, they're gonna knock over a lot of water glasses. One thing they're not going to do is vote, right? And I hate to say this, but it is true. If you don't vote, you don't matter, right? And it's plain and simple. You can look at the voting turnout of 18 to 24-year-olds growing up to 2010. These numbers are still the same today. So you can protest, you can have a mean tweet, you can watch whatever TV show you want. If you don't vote, it don't matter, right? And they don't vote. So this is not something that Lyndon Johnson, a politician to his core, is gonna be able to manage. How do you manage this? Oh, how about if we legalize weed? How about 420? How do we do these kinds of things? Well, fine. Those are kind of issues, but they're not connected to the idea of someone seeing the political process as a means of real reform. Right? So this change is going to take place at a natural level. They're going to focus on cultural changes. And again, I'm a cultural historian. I find this stuff fascinating, but it is not politics. Right? Again, these are people who have got a unique environment, just like you guys do. Now, you guys have it harder in the sense you got to work and all that kind of material. But they're upset with these notions of how society is unfolding, right? Vietnam being one of those. And they're going to, in large part, say, I just don't want to be a part of I don't care, right? I'm just gonna drop out and tune in. I'm gonna get high and do whatever I want to. I'm not going to engage in the hard work of political passing of legislation, of changing this kind of stuff. And it sounds, again, like the Kennedy kind of thing. Oh, well, you're bashing on the hippies and what have you. No, it's just a political reality. And when you look at the people who are the influencers of this period of time, who better than the Beatles, right? And so, again, the Beatles are going to go to the United States in 1968 when this kind of peaks in 1968, Summer of Love. You know, George Harrison is the one who's going to be kind of...
I mean, everywhere we went, people were smiling and... You know, sitting on lawns, drinking tea, you know, festivals of music and stuff. I mean, you know, that Summer of Love, a lot of that was bullshit, really. It was all what the press was saying, but it was definitely a vibe. I mean, America, we could feel what was going on there, even though we were miles away. You could just pick up the vibes, you know.
I was all for going there and living on the face, you know. I mean, in my head, I thought, well, hell, the acid's in Mississippi, so let's go. I'll go there, you know, make music and all that. But of course, it didn't come true. In the end, George went over.
You know, I went to Haight Ashbury, expecting it to be this brilliant place, and it was just full of horrible, spotty, dropout kids on drugs.
George Harrison in the middle of it. What he concludes with this, and this is when Harrison basically steps away from drug use, is it's alcoholism. This is the worst side of the counterculture. This is the low side. This is the kind of hedonistic side of the counterculture. What does the counterculture do well? You saw an example of it. Just because you're old doesn't mean you get to get all the, you're not the smartest person in the room. Just because you grew up in a certain environment doesn't mean that's how I am growing up. You don't have to dress a certain way. Your hair doesn't have to be a certain way. Your body image doesn't have to be a certain way. All of these are empowering. All of these are saying you are the only person in the world who is you. You've got validity just simply being yourself, that notion of individualism. But it does, which are all praiseworthy, and Americans lean into that in a hard way, right? We love that stuff. Oh, it's about me. But it eats away at this idea that there's a social obligation to the person sitting next to you. Right? I want to do this. I want to do that. I want to get up and do, you know, I want to have to all those kinds of things. It's a cultural expression. And cultural expressions are powerful, but they're not lasting laws. Right? Culture is not politics. And it happens in a relatively brief period of time. It's the reason why I keep talking about where are the hippies, where are the hippies. They don't exist until 68. They don't exist until, and they're largely an expression of the 1970s. And by the time I've brought this book in a couple of times, and I strongly recommend if you're interested in this period of time, Conquest of Cool, right? And this guy's not even a historian, so he actually writes well. But I'm going to read this passage early on. He goes, the counterculture, what distinguishes the precise, authentic counterculture from the fake, by almost every account, the counterculture as a mass movement was distinct from the bohemians of the 1950s, but it was triggered by much of the developments of mass culture. Changes at the grassroots. Its heroes were rock stars and rebel celebrities, millionaires, performers, employees of the culture industries, movie stars, rock and rollers, etc. Its greatest moments occurred on television or the radio, at rock concerts, or in movies, each from a distinct 30 distance of 30 years when this book was written. Its language and music seemed anything but authentic. They yearned so desperately to be authentic, from the contrived cursing of Woody Guthrie, etc., etc., to the Doors, he goes through this long list. The relics of the counterculture reek of affectation and phoniness. We consume it. We want to be cool, so we act a certain way. We do a certain thing. I used to wear my hair much longer, right? You ask people around. And I'll never forget when I finally cut it. I got older, and I was like, you know, old guys have long hair. That's not my style. Cut my hair. I had students come up to me, and they're like, Marky, you sold out. I was like, it's just hair. I haven't changed a bit, but it's just hair. Oh, no, you've sold out. You're no longer, I'm the man now, or what have you. Culture is an expression, and it's an important thing, and it means something. Right? If you're a sports fan, you know what I'm talking about. If you're a Bulls fan, you're a Bulls fan, by God. You hate Detroit. but it doesn't necessarily translate into national politics. It creates a nation of individual consumers. That's what he's talking about, is that Madison Avenue was all over this shit. They were selling it wholesale to the American public. By the time we get to the 1970s, you got the Smothers Brothers, you've got these TV shows, you've got people tuning in to consume it. And consumers are not the same as activists. They're not the same as doing something. You've heard me say this before. The biggest regret I have about higher education in my career is the consumerist attitude that's crept in. I'm not gonna come in and engage in my professors. I'm not gonna engage in my own education. I'm not gonna challenge my own assumptions. I'm a consumer. And if something is said that I don't like, well, by God, I'm not buying it, right? That is a sad statement on this society, but it is very much a part of this consumed process, right? That's as much a part of the 60s as anything else. And I'm not, you know, we also are the product of the good things about it, right? We don't have to wear suits and ties. Our language is more informal. The notion of who we are is more important because it is important to us individually, right? Party politics becomes, in essence, this distant shore where everyone is like, I'm going to be a Republican because culturally, this is what I believe. Not ideologically, because I'm going to say conservatism means you got to go to church. I'm going to say liberalism means you have to recycle or drive an electric car. None of that is in the basic concepts here. This is where you want to make sure and do a full stop. Lyndon Johnson as the 60s is full level progressivism, classical, organic progressivism. The state can step in and try to change basic conditions for people who need them. Change the environment, change poverty, change healthcare, et cetera, et cetera. At the same time, the counterculture, which is going along at the same time, is gonna say, oh, now it's all these stone professors who are in Berkeley or whatever, who are, you know, doing this stuff because it's gonna get them tenure, right? That's a cultural argument. And the two things are going along in parallel. It's complicated, it's complex. It isn't something that fits on a chyron at the bottom of a news television show. And yet that's the society, that's the kind of political discourse that a lot of people want you to have, right? Go ahead, you're more than welcome to, but my argument is it's much more interesting to understand what is actually going on here, right? The unintended political consequences, number one, of youth culture is there. Number two is that the modern civil rights movement is going to continue, and it's going to continue on multiple fronts. Call this identity politics or whatever, there are multiple possibilities in which this is going to be expressed. Clearly, the growth of the Hispanic population, again, the terminology is always odd. The 50s and 60s is when you see the explosion of Hispanics in the United States as a demographic population. They go from less than 5% to close to 20% in basically two decades. Massive growth. Right? And they bring with them a civil rights movement equally affected by the same kinds of racist and kind of stereotypic assumptions. Again, the terminology that's used is contentious. There are entire classes, and I strongly suggest you take one of them, on Mexican-American history or Hispanic history. But even that terminology, right? So, I mean, Texas is, the majority of Hispanics are Mexican origins, one of the greatest neighbors we've ever had, right? But up in Chicago, for example, they're dominated by Puerto Ricans. Right? They're not Mexican Americans. They don't see themselves in the same kind of context. La Raza United, for example, by 1969, is going to split generationally. A colleague of mine who subsequently retired looked at, looked at a local Texas city and basically sees that the distinction in the civil rights movement is going to cleave in the 1950s and 1960s around generational differences. Older Mexican Americans are going to look at themselves as Mexican Americans. Younger Mexican Americans are going to see themselves as part of this La Raza United, the idea of Chicanoism. It's going to divide the population themselves more than anything else. But what you see here is a new political stream entering into the political debate. And same thing is true for American Indians. American Indian movement explodes. Native Americans. I always like the Canadians use the term First Nations. I don't know why I like that one much better. But the idea is that there is contractual. The United States has literal treaties with these folks that allow them to do things that are different. Right? It allows them to have casinos, allows them to grow weed, allows them to do all kinds of things, brew alcohol. these are traditional rights that have in large part been ignored and are going to be kind of accentuated. And I won't kind of be able to finish here today, but certain sexuality is also a part of this as well. The gay and lesbian movement of the 1960s reflects, again, you go back in history to, cavemen. There's always been homosexuality. There's always been sexual practices that are beyond just simply monogamy heterosexuality. Generally, what you see is a percentage of around 10 to 12%, 10 to 15% in most societies. When it's expressed, by and large, again, the men are going to have more freedoms than women throughout American history, right? And they're going to congregate at gay bars to be able to have sexual intercourse, have interactions in that environment. The police would frequently bust these and do shakedowns. So you could either be put in the newspaper the next day as part of a bust at a gay bar, or you could give your money over to the cop and they would let you go, et cetera, et cetera. At one of these shakedowns, what you see is a response. So again, I apologize for taking you just to the moment here. We'll pick this up again on Friday, and then we'll finish the 16th and pick up